Worship no other gods, for the Lord, whose very name is jealous, is a God who is jealous about his relationship with you. Bear with me for just a few minutes today as I attempt to preach on the subject, how can a good God be a jealous God?
Amen.
How can a good God be a jealous God? Jealousy is an ugly word. Jealousy is all the fun you think they had. Erica Jong, novelist and poet. Jealousy is the fear of comparison. Max Frisch, Swiss playwright and novelist. A Jewish philosopher from the first millennium said, jealousy is cruel as the grave. The coals thereof are coals of fire. And a famous French writer in the 17th century said, jealousy contains more of self-love than of love. That same writer said, jealousy is bred in doubts. When those doubts change into certainties, then the passion either ceases or turns absolute madness. And according to one anonymous writer, jealousy is a tiger that tears not only its prey, but also its own raging heart. We view jealousy as an awful attribute which destroys friendships and marriages because it stems from selfishness, suspicion, distrust, hostility, and a need to possess and control both the outcomes of our actions and the feelings of others. Today's scripture says that God's very name is jealous. This line is the same idea as expressed in Exodus 20, verse 5, Deuteronomy 4, verse 24, and several other places in the Bible. It's the very argument used against God by those who don't believe he exists or don't want to obey him. The argument is, how can a God be jealous and also be loving and good? Because the Bible says over and over again that God loves us, does it not?
Amen.
And yet the Bible also says that love is not jealous in 1 Corinthians 13 and 4. Again, the Bible says that jealousy is a sin that separates us from God in James chapter 3, verses 14 through 16. Doesn't that make a God a hypocrite if he exists? If someone who doubted God asked you, how can God be both loving and jealous, how would you answer them? Maybe you've asked the same question. Obviously, the Bible is right when it tells us that jealousy is a bad thing. Just recently, the entire country has been reminded of the ugly results of jealousy as they followed the trial and conviction of young George Hughley for the murder of his fellow lacrosse player and sometime girlfriend, Yardley Love, right down the road in Charlottesville, Virginia. Apparently, Mr. Hughley wanted Miss Love to belong to him, and when she didn't agree any longer, he got drunk, busted down her door, and smashed her head against the wall, resulting in her death. It's not a new story, just new players. Are we supposed to fear that kind of retribution from God for our misbehavior when we think of his words, I am a jealous God? Are we expecting God to knock down our doors and smash our heads if we go too far from him? If that's what jealousy looks like, how can jealousy in any way be connected with a loving God? And yet the Bible says that he is both loving and jealous. And the Bible also says he is always the same and never contradicts himself. Now, jealousy doesn't usually push us as far as killing someone, as George Hughley did. For instance, when I was 6 or 7 years old, there was a popular doll that was about 2 feet tall, I think, and talked when you pulled a string attached to her back. Some of you might know her. Her name was Chatty. Chatty Cathy, exactly. Did you have that doll? Well, Chatty Cathy was too expensive for my parents to buy me one. But Debbie Barone down the street had one, and we played with it together. But playing with the doll wasn't enough for me. One day, I walked by Debbie Barone's house and saw that she had left Chatty Cathy on the porch. And no one was around. I thought, OMG, see. I'd never leave that wonderful doll out on the porch if I had her. Debbie must really not appreciate Chatty Cathy. Don't we all sometimes have those thoughts when we want something that someone else has and we're upset about it? Deserve that more than she does. He really doesn't appreciate what he has, but I would. It should be mine! So I stepped up on the porch and took Debbie Barone's doll home with me. When I got home, my mother asked me where the doll came from, and I told her, I thought very convincingly, that Debbie Barone did not want the doll. She was tired of it, and she had given it to me. My mother, however, is a very wise woman, and she wisely did not believe me, and made me immediately turn around, go back out the door, and return Chatty Cathy to Debbie Barone. Jealousy had moved me to steal and lie all in one afternoon, moved me to commit two sins in less than 2 minutes. If that's what jealousy looks like, who would want to serve a jealous God? How could we trust a God like that? As Arsenio Hall used to say on his talk show back in the early 90s, this is one of those things that makes you go, exactly. So I'm driving to work a few days ago wondering whether I should talk about something else today other than jealousy, because my Chatty Cathy moment was almost 50 years ago, and that's the biggest and clearest jealousy moment I can remember in my life. I've, of course, had many flashes of jealousy since then, but they rarely last longer than a second or two before I squash them or get distracted by something else. Jealousy just doesn't happen to be something I relate to very deeply. So I'm driving to work thinking, where did you get this idea to talk about jealousy? Why don't you talk about something else that you do feel a little more deeply? The answer came, God deposited this inspiration in your heart. Somebody needs to hear it. And of course, my own little voice in my head answered, really? No way. You should just change the subject. So I arrive at work, and as soon as I walk in, all I did was ask one of my coworkers, how are you doing this morning? So I worked with this guy for almost 2 years, and he's never even hinted at any personal issues with me before. All I asked was, how are you this morning? And suddenly he opened up and told me about something that had happened that morning that had made his wife pretty jealous, and he shared his anguish over how to deal with it. You never know who's going through what, so if God tells you to share something, share it. It sounds terrible, but it was all I could do not to laugh while this guy was telling me about the text message he got from someone he really didn't know, and they're in another country to boot, and how the wording of the message got his wife all upset and very vocal. But I wanted to laugh because it was obvious to me that God was using him to confirm that my topic for today had to be jealousy. It was obvious that my coworker really didn't want to tell me the story in the first place. He seemed more surprised to be sharing it with me than I was to be hearing it. So I know God was using him. Amen. Does God ever do that?
Yes. Amen.
So we see and know that jealousy can move us to lie, steal, say ugly things to people we care about, and even to kill. And God says he's jealous? But does God lie to us?
No.
Does God steal from us?
No.
Does God have tantrums?
No,
not that I know of. Does God smash our heads or shoot us in a jealous rage? Absolutely no. So what are we missing about jealousy? Jealousy is evil and does separate us from God. It says so in the Bible, and that fact is easily observed when we look at the things that we do under the influence of jealousy. But God is jealous? Let's think about this. Come here, jealousy. Come here, love. Let's see. Love is beautiful. God is love. Jealousy is ugly. God is jealous? But God never changes. No wonder atheists and some of us are confused by this seeming contradiction. How can God be loving, good all the time, truthful, and unchanging, and still be jealous? First, we have to understand that there are two Hebrew words in the original Old Testament that have both been translated into English as jealous. And there are two Greek words in the original New Testament that have both been translated into English as jealous. There are several meanings for all of the original Hebrew and Greek words, and the meaning is only apparent based on context. One of the Hebrew words for jealousy, kana, is only used when talking about God. That word is never, ever used in the original Bible when talking about human jealousy. So it's not so much that the English Bible translations using the word jealousy or sometimes envy in its place are wrong. It's just that modern languages sometimes are less expressive or less differentiated than the ancient tongues. Greeks and Hebrews sometimes had two, three, or four or more different words for different aspects of the same idea, and all of them might be translated into only one English word. Without getting into an in-depth word study here or linguistics class, what we need to understand is that even when we use the same word, sometimes we are talking about different things. Sometimes jealousy and envy mean the same thing, and sometimes they don't. Aristotle demonstrated this when he said, jealousy is both reasonable and belongs to reasonable men, while envy is base and belongs to the base. For the one makes himself get good things through jealousy, and the other prevents his neighbor from getting good things through envy. The Merriam-Webster Dictionary gives three definitions for the word jealous. First, intolerance of unfaithfulness. Second, hostile toward a rival or one believed to enjoy an advantage. And three, vigilant in guarding a possession. The difference between human jealousy and God's jealousy is not so much in the definition, but in the application. Let me repeat that. The difference between human jealousy and God's jealousy is not so much in the definition of the word, but in the application. People are capable of righteous jealousy, which inspires us to work harder and do better in order to protect our good names or the sanctity of our marriages, for instance. But people are far more prone to sinful jealousy. We do so much dirt in the name of jealousy because we can't stand someone else having either possessions or accolades or love that we think should be ours or that we want. We see each other as rivals for a limited supply of whatever it is we want, and we are ready to hate each other or fight each other or talk bad about each other or all of the above, as if doing those things will make us feel better about what we think we're missing. God, however, has no rivals. He created the world and everything in it belongs to him. He knows everything, so he's never shocked or disappointed. He does have feelings, but they can't be hurt in the same way that our feelings get hurt. God doesn't strike back at anyone out of resentment. So what does it mean that God is jealous, then? Let's revisit that third definition of jealous from Merriam-Webster's dictionary, vigilant in guarding a possession. Now, as we examine the text today, what is God saying to his people? Is he saying, watch out because I'm jealous and I'm going to get you if you cheat on me? No. Did I say no? No. Atheists read the text that way, and even many Christians read it that way because we're applying human feelings to God. He has feelings, but they're not our feelings. So what is God saying to his people? What was he saying then to his chosen people, the Hebrews, before they entered the Promised Land? What is he saying today to us, his adopted children, Christians, through these same words? This scripture is not about fear and punishment. This scripture is about love. L-O-V-E, love. God's feelings are not our feelings. God is speaking to his people in this scripture that we read today through Moses, in response to their plea through Moses, for God to stay with them and not abandon them. They were afraid but still rebellious, just as we often are. We mess up all the time and then we scream, "Oh God!" as if God went somewhere that he can't hear us. As Pastor often says, if you can't feel the presence of God any longer, guess who moved? God is saying in today's scripture, of course I'll stay with you, I love you. But listen to me, he's saying, can't you hear him? Stop turning against me, he says, can't you hear him? What you never want to hear God say is what he said in the book of Hosea, the 4th chapter, the 17th verse, about the tribe of Ephraim. Ephraim is joined to idols. Let him alone. But listen now. Your life will be ruined, God is saying, if you hang out with people who hate on me and you follow their ways instead of mine. God is saying, I want you, I love you, but I have rules and I can't break them. If I did, I'd be no better than you, would I? God is saying, I keep telling you that death is a consequence of sin, and you keep sinning. Stop! Stop because I love you. Stop because you love me. Yes, stop in the name of love before you break my heart. Please stop, he's saying, because I don't want you to die. I don't want you to be separated from me. I don't want you to end up in hell. How do I know that's what God means? How do I know that I'm right, that God loves us and he's not a hypocrite as his haters say he is? How do I know? Because God sent his only begotten son, Jesus, to die in our place to pay for all of our sins. He died to pay the price that we owe. He proved he loves us that much. Jesus allowed himself to be beaten, cursed, cut, bruised, nailed to a lonely cross, placed on a rocky hill called Golgotha. What kept Jesus up on that cross? Love kept him on that cross. When Jesus was hung high and heckled, he thought little of himself, but took the time to talk to a thief who humbly turned to him. And he promised that thief that there was hope. The hope was in eternity with him. It was love that kept him there. Amen. He was spit on, mocked, yet Jesus begged his Father's forgiveness for his torturers, including us. Because he loves us so much, and God does forgive us if we only accept that gift from Jesus, because that was always his plan since before the world began. If we only stop and love him, he forgives us. And I thank him in Jesus' name. The power of love kept him on that cross. And the power of love, of his love, gives me the right now to stand here and give the invitation, the best invitation you've ever had, if you haven't had it before, for anyone who doesn't know Jesus in the pardon of their sins. The doors of the church are open now for you to receive him in your heart. If there's one, please come right now.